If you're an adult with ADD or ADHD, you know how frustrating it is to read the same sentence over and over without it absorbing, to not be able to stay organized, have trouble prioritizing tasks, to hear everything at once, but nothing at all, to look before you leap and struggle to follow through. It's hard to get help when you need help with something that you are supposed to outgrow. That's where my next guest comes in. She's been a psychotherapist for over 30 years, certified ADHD coach, international ADHD researcher, and fellow ADDer. In fact, she read her first book, cover to cover, every word, when she was in her early 50s after learning to repattern her brain. Today, she's going to offer insight and answer questions. Dog mom to Pink, the golden retriever. Persistent problem solver. Fellow podcaster, Dr. Barbara Cohen, everyone. Yay! Welcome to the show.
Thank you so much for having me here today.
I'm so glad that you came. So, you know, the big question, maybe our starting question, is how do you know as an adult if you have ADD and ADHD, and if you could help us know the difference?
Sure. So first of all, there is no more ADD.
Oh, no?
That is a term. Let me explain. That's a term that existed years ago before they changed the diagnostic criteria. So now, which makes it even more confusing for the people that need to not be confused, everything is ADHD, and then there's three subsets. Subset one, primarily inattentive. Subset two, hyperactive and or impulsive. Subset three, combination of all of it. That's so everybody walking around who gets a diagnosis of ADHD, and then people say, but I'm not hyperactive. Right, but your diagnosis is still ADHD, primarily inattentive category.
I had no idea.
Yep, most people don't. And in terms of how do you know, there's not even a gold standard anymore. In 2013, when the diagnostic manual, the DSM-5, as it's referred to, changed the criteria, one, they did not include a diagnostic code for adult ADHD. We don't have one. We are diagnosed with a code that is used for kids and teens. They only included examples of what it looks like in adults. So I just don't feel like it gave much validity to millions of adults. Plus, they lowered the criteria standards so that more and more people can get diagnosed. I'm not sure why they did this, because it then becomes a joke in society. Oh, ADD, ADD, you're ADD, you know, which isn't even the right term anymore, but it's a shorthand and people use ADD a lot. And we all, in this kind of brain, we all know what it means anyway.
That's really interesting. So how do you know if what you're experiencing as an adult is ADHD, or if it's just, I'm a little spacey, I'm a little forgetful, I'm a little antsy, or I'm an active person? What are some differences if someone's listening right now that they can just do a quick self-assessment?
So if they want to go online and they want to look up the DSM-5 criteria, they can do that. They'll see a complete listing of the criteria that they need to meet in order to get a diagnosis. It's online. So are all these different quizzes and things like that. Because again, with no gold standard, anyone who's diagnosing and assessing could use anything to diagnose, which is terrible. Because when I do diagnostics, not only am I looking at that criteria, which means basically if you meet six, I think it is, or five for adults now, in inattentive or impulsive, hyperactive, or the combined, you have to have it be challenging in at least, I think it's two areas of life, let's say work and home, or any two areas, but it needs to be making a significant impact or detriment in a negative way in your life. Otherwise, yeah, there's a lot of people that are spacey. There's a lot of people that check out. People check out who are depressed. People check out who are anxious. People who check out when they time travel from traumas. People check out for all kinds of reasons, even with addictions. So just being a little bit spacey and checking out, who knows? Maybe you didn't want to hear what the person was saying. Hmm. Maybe you don't like anybody that you listen to. So you check out.
So it's
that isn't a diagnostic criteria by itself.
That's true. So it's better to go on to that website, and I'll make sure I link that so everyone can look at it if they need to really get a full spectrum of the symptoms and signs. So you mentioned work. What are some ways that ADHD shows up in the workplace?
One area certainly, and I've helped people with accommodations, is the distractions of working, of working in an area where there's not room division, like maybe a cubicle, but you can hear and see too many people, too many distractions, people walking around, too many things happening, overhearing conversations, as opposed to having your own office, even if it doesn't warrant that kind of position in a company. And there are accommodations that your listeners can get to see that they get put into an environment that they can do their work without distractions. You have to ask. Sometimes you have to fight for it, but you're entitled to it as an accommodation with our wonderful kinds of brains.
Yes, our wonderful kinds of brains. I love that. We do have actually a listener from our question from a listener, Christine Elizabeth, wanted to know about some management techniques, self-management, and working with others with ADHD in the office. And she kind of had a two-part question, and also those with ADHD and anxiety in the office. So to kind of pull that together, I would say, what can employers or team leaders at work in workspaces do to accommodate people who say, hey, I need some help, but they don't know what kind of help that they need. They don't know what kind of accommodations that they need.
So it's a difficult question, but what I can say is, for employers, first get educated, because most of the employers aren't educated. They think that people can do what they can't do. They see them focusing in certain arenas, situations, projects they're working on, and they figure it's straight across the board and they don't get it. Mm. And there are certain things, whether it's more technical, more detailed, more something, where they can't. And if you want even performance, then listen to the employee. If we're talking about employees, listen to them. When they tell you they cannot do certain things, they can't. If they could, they would. Mm-hmm. Do you think anybody wants to fail or underachieve or feel ridiculed or embarrassed because they can't do certain things? So that old saying, if we could, we would, is true. And they can't. So when they tell you they can't do certain things, listen. And then figure out together, brainstorm together, how can you make it work so that they can? Because they want it to work as much as you want it to work. So negotiate, brainstorm, work on it together so that it can work. Mm-hmm. The other thing you asked about anxiety, if you want me to respond to that as well,
yeah, absolutely,
is, all right, I digress for one point here, which is, your listeners need to understand that nowhere in the United States is there any requirement at all, zero, for any mental health professional to study anything about adult ADHD or executive function development. Zero. I call my licensing board at least every couple of years. They won't put it on the docket. They won't add CEUs for a solid education after licensure. I started calling boards across the U.S. I don't know about abroad, but I can talk about U.S. solid. No place is there anything in the academia, the last I checked, to know anything about us. And nothing to get a license to know anything about us. So your listeners, when they go to a therapist, the very first most important question to ask, have you studied anything outside of mainstream education on the way to your license about me, about adult ADHD and executive function? Because if the answer is no, be careful, because mental health professionals, at least many, many, I haven't met everyone, obviously, many feel that they can help anyone that they have training to help. But if you don't have training in adult ADHD and executive function development, then how, pray tell, are you going to help people? People go for marriage counseling, where therapists don't have training in factoring in ADHD and executive function issues into marriage counseling. That's usually the bigger issue. So how are you going to help those people? They get divorced needlessly. It isn't right. So in terms of anxiety, often people get diagnosed with anxiety or depression because that's studied in school. You can look at someone sitting in front of you, do an assessment, know they are depressed, know they have anxiety. And because you don't know anything about adult ADHD, you don't go further. And you don't identify the ADHD. So you try to treat for depression and anxiety, which never seems to subside. This was part of my journey because nobody knew ADHD. Nobody knew, you know, executive function issues. So diagnoses for depression and anxiety, let's treat that. Gee, let me imagine I'm depressed and I'm anxious because my brain functions differently and no one has identified that. And then no one has taught me the necessary executive function skills that I was missing. So I underachieve, I'm depressed, I'm anxious, I'm frustrated, I'm a million and one emotions, plus it's traumatic. And my self-esteem takes a dive and all these things happen until ADHD is identified and then addressed. And then lo and behold, depending on the person's history, anxiety subsides, depression subsides. If those two were connected to the fact that ADHD was the reason I was depressed and anxious because I couldn't remember and I couldn't this and I couldn't that, of course that would be depressing. Of course it would make you anxious if you have to give a presentation and all of a sudden it's time to present and your mind clamps shut and everything you know so well, it isn't there. And the harder you try to get to it, the tighter it shuts down until now the time is over for the presentation and you know everything you were going to say.
So it sounds like knowing, getting, figuring out if that is your special superpower, as I like to say, if ADHD is a part of your superpower tool belt, that's the key. So maybe take that quiz that you mentioned first. And then the second thing that I'm hearing you say is be your own advocate. If figure out what you need. I can, when you were talking, I was remembering that there were times where I was in like a professional setting and there was a television on and I had to be like, guys, can we just shut that TV on? Sorry, I'm just, you know, I can't hear it and hear you, and I really want to hear you right now. So I didn't even use the words ADHD or, you know, I was afraid it would be too dismissive. And quite frankly, I, as I've told you, I've never been officially diagnosed, but just to frame it in a way like, hey, I want to be here with you and I can if that TV's on, or I can't talk to you while driving and the radio is on. Sorry. So to speak up for what you need. You've mentioned several times now executive function, and I would love for you to explain what that is and give some examples.
I'd love to. The one thing, if I could just quickly comment on what you were talking about in terms of splitting your attention between sound, I can't do that either. When multiple people are talking to me, I can't listen to multiple conversations at the same time. I don't know if other people can, but I know I can't. And I tell people, I want to hear what each of you is saying. You're going to have to take turns. Mm-hmm. Because if you don't take turns, I'm not going to hear anybody. And same thing in a restaurant, sound. I can't separate out the sound to be able to hear the person I went with. Dentist's office, they put on TV. Oh my God, please turn it off. Doctor's office, all of, there's enough busyness in here.
Yeah.
I don't need other stuff unless I want it.
Do you always have a song in your head? I do. Just wondering.
Not necessarily a song, but lots going on.
Yeah.
And this is the other thing too. And then I will talk about the executive function because it's the bigger issue I see for adults, much more than ADHD, is there's a thing called cognitive hyperactivity, not just hyperactivity. So when you're talking about the song, cognitive hyperactivity is this busyness in our head that it often isn't quiet all day. There's something going on.
No, yeah, there's
other
always.
Other people, it gets quiet in here. And if you're a meditator, you can get it quiet in there. If you're in nature or other things, you might get it quiet in there. But typically, it isn't. So cognitive hyperactivity is going to show up much more than the hyperactivity that you would see in a kid. Mm. So we aren't going to be like looking like this as adults, although some of us do, and I still wiggle and move sometimes when I get excited like that. But I think that a lot of people are missing cognitive hyperactivity so that you aren't truly inattentive primarily, you're both, because you're not hyper this way, but you're hyper in here. So you are a combination of both, and there are things to address the cognitive hyperactivity.
Well, I think we just made a breakthrough because I just wanted to make sure
that your listeners knew that. In terms of executive function, examples, being able to inhibit, meaning pause, stop, consider. Yeah, right. Mm-hmm. All of these, back up a step, all of these executive functions are skills. They can be learned. It does not matter your age or your stage in life. I've worked with people and continue to work with people younger, older, up to their 70s, their 80s. If you're still walking around on the planet and breathing and thinking and you've got mind function, you can learn skills. Skills is like boiling water, tying your shoelaces, riding a bike, things like that. Those are skills, swimming, skills, driving a car. Skills of being able to learn to pause is a skill. Being able to regulate your emotions is a skill. Being able to shift from this to this to this is a skill. Some people get stuck. They can't unplug to be able to shift. Things like initiating, which is getting started. And getting started isn't just leaping in and flying by the seat of your pants and then stalling out because you don't know what to do to keep going. There's a methodology to the skill of initiating that you can learn. Mm-hmm. Planning, organizing, scheduling, prioritizing, foresight. See the cliff before you're going over the cliff so you're not, I'm in a free fall. The list just goes on and on. I teach about 13 of these essential executive function skills in my program. This is a 6-month program.
That's great.
Because what I find is, and maybe this will be news to you and your listeners as well, ADHD, in my opinion, are the three core symptoms of ADHD, which is being inattentive, hyperactive or impulsive, or the combination of those three, including cognitive hyperactivity. To me, that's all that ADD is. But if you look at the DSM-5, it has a list that includes all the executive, a lot of the executive function things. to me, that's misleading to the layperson, to the public, because medication only addresses the three core symptoms. It was not designed to address skills. And because there's no skills in pills, nothing is going to come of taking the medication that's all of a sudden miraculously going to get you organized and prioritizing and getting started and following through and on and on. Ain't going to do that.
No. That's so good. I have so many things flashing through my head, of course, but you would know that because I'm like, oh my gosh, this is so, I can't wait for listeners to hear this. I can't believe how fast this time is flying either. So if you don't mind, we're going to rapid fire some listener questions because people want to talk to you.
Okay. And I want to talk to them.
So as quickly as you can, we'll run through these. All right. There was one, here it is. Jason Edwards, he says, when the lows hit and your mind is so busy and you get stuck in an unproductive funk, which for those who don't have ADHD, that's when you like hyper-focus and you just can't unstick it. What are some exercises to pull yourself out quick?
Well, what he's talking about, at least one of the skills is shifting. So if I was assessing him with the assessment that I use, and it showed that he had a huge deficit in the development of his shifting ability, then he's going to be stuck because he needs to learn this skill. He needs to learn how to shift from thing to thing. And so one of the things that I use is music. I love music. And so let's say the way that I use music, and maybe this will work for him, is I love the original Rocky theme song. I love it. Mm-hmm. I mean, I can hear it in my head. I can see the scene that's for the main theme. And I might wake up some morning and I just don't feel like getting up yet. It's just one of those days. Doesn't happen often, but it happens. So on my phone is the Rocky theme. And I know that the minute I sense that I'm not like in that state to get up and go, I punch the button, on comes the Rocky theme. I cannot stay in bed. I'm already envisioning running down the street and the kids and the stairs and all of that, and I've got to get up. And that theme will carry. So music can change our state really easily. Hmm. Another thing that you can use comes from neurolinguistics, NLP, which is that you can shift your state by using something that's called a break state, which is using something that is so absurd and so ridiculous, it just makes you laugh. And it's like that old joke of squirrel, squirrel, squirrel is a break state. Okay. Because whatever we were doing, now we're over here. Now we're over here. Now we're over here. It's a break state. So imagine a man running down the street in the middle of the street in his boxer shorts with balloons and bubbles all attached all over, just floating up in the air from him. And it's like, really, where would I find somebody like that? And while my brain is so busy processing this, it's not stuck in the place that it was stuck in, processing whatever it was I was stuck in before. It's thinking about his boxer shorts and the bubbles and the balloons and all this absurdity. And the more absurd you can make the image and more powerful, the easier it is to break your state.
Oh, that's so good. Those are two really good tips. I like them because they're easily, they're memorable. I can remember those. So tell, as we wrap up, tell people where they can find you online, about your programs that you have going on, how they can learn more to have just a better quality of life and see their ADHD as a superpower and not as a deficit.
Okay. So you all can find me at my website, which is drbarbaracohen.com. And I think it's going to be in your show notes as well.
Yes.
And I would love if you all would come over and ask to join my Facebook group, which is the same name as my podcast show, Living Beyond ADHD with Dr. B, because it's a place that I go live. I answer questions. There's a link there for you to ask me any question that you want. There's an Ask Dr. B little link there. So it's confidential because some people don't feel comfortable putting their questions publicly, which is why I do that. I want to basically preserve whatever you're comfortable doing. So you can ask questions. I'll answer them. I'll do a video. I'll do a podcast episode. I'll even engage in conversation on Messenger or wherever you want and talk to you about these things. Also, twice a year, I launch a program. The next time it's going to launch is coming up in June of this year. It's a six-month program that specializes in teaching you all these executive function skills that I've been talking about. There's coaching that's live. There's instruction that's live. Everything is recorded. There's a forum. I'm in there 6 days a week answering questions from all of my students. I'm there basically to serve everyone who comes into my life because I've decided that my mission is really to put an end to this needless suffering of people not knowing there's things they can do, even if they don't have a diagnosis, like what you mentioned about yourself. Mm-hmm. You don't need a diagnosis of ADHD or anything else to improve these skills. And these skills need improvement with so many of us, mm-hmm. no matter what has caused the derailment or underdevelopment of them.
I agree.
And so this is where my focus is you have a gift. I have a gift. All your listeners came to this life with a gift.
Yeah.
I selfishly want to see the gifts of as many people as I can in the rest of my lifetime, maybe 30 more years or whatever since I'm 69. And I want to do what I can to help people to make manifest those gifts and bring them to life. Mm-hmm. Because we as a collective have gifts to bring and do amazing things when we are capable.
Oh, preach, sister. Amen. I love it. I feel so motivated now. Thank you so much. I really believe that you are giving people hope and identity and tools. And I just hope that they get in touch with you. So if you're listening or you're watching this, make sure that you check out Dr. B's resources. They'll be emailed out, but you can find them in the show notes as well. Text REAL to 66866 and be in touch. So thank you again. That was so awesome. That's a wrap. You did great.
You can head over to drbarbaracohen.com and find the podcast transcript, great free content, plus information on programs and services, including the groundbreaking Adventures in Achievement online coaching program and one-to-one services with Dr. B. That's drbarbaracohen.com.